So we're going to go back to before a majority of our food, some say 80% of our food, was shipped from off-island. We're going to go back to a time before we shipped about 80% of what we grow off-island. We're going to go back before petrochemicals and monocrops and papayas and cattle and sugarcane. We're going to go back a time before all the sandalwood trees were cut down here in Puna. We're going to go back to a time before colonization, and we unfortunately lost some estimates of 90% of the indigenous population. So we're going to go back to a time where people first settled this island. I think often this story is told through a very objective historical lens, and it doesn't take into account the human story and the heart of that. So I want to share with you what I perceive to be my account of that, with some liberties, of course, because it is a story. So when people first settled here, like all seafaring people, they settle the coast, right? That's where they're comfortable. They're not sure they're going to root in real deeply. And they're still looking for a more permanent home. So they settle the coast until their needs are met, until they feel like they find something that they're looking for as far as safety or abundance or ease of navigation, things like that. And one of those places was like Kalapana, where the lava flows in right now, right? This is one of the main settling points for the indigenous people of this island. And once they felt secure and comfortable as a home, they do what most hunter-gatherers have done that settle. They begin to move inland. So hunter-gatherers generally transition, or maybe fisher-foragers in this regard, generally transition into agriculturalists or agrarian society. And so the Hawaiian people did that in their own way. As they moved up inland, for whatever reason, for curiosity or to get away from their parents, or they liked the trees better than the sea, just like any of us, we have our preferences. So people moved up inland of their own accord to get their needs met and the needs of their family. They were pioneers and they were explorers, and then they became settlers. Like many of us that are new to this island, they started off with their basic needs: food, water, shelter, building up for their family, making themselves comfortable. And what that would look like probably is building a small house, collecting some water, and building a garden. And they used many of their food crops that they brought here, the canoe plants, the bananas and coconuts and breadfruits and sweet potatoes, and everyone's aware of some of these staples here. And they used those and they cultivated them. And they took very great care of them to create abundance for them, themselves and their family, to get their kind of root or their own needs met at that time. Once that became more stable and they had abundance, then of course they would begin to reach out, right? It could be just their kids were like, "Mom, really, we're going to have bread food again?" And like, "Okay, no, Uncle's going down to the ocean next week, and he'll bring up some fish, and we'll trade some of that breadfruit for fish," right? So the breadfruit rolled downhill, and the fish got thrown uphill, and people traded really casually at first, right? Anyone that has worked on a farm or creates a yield know that we have a high abundance of any one crop, and it just makes sense to share that or trade that, either for money or for direct, and to get something in return, and that way, we all have equal parts, or we have what we need, right? So that was happening. People were cultivating their gardens. And again, it was a very different time, of course. They didn't have modern technology, and they didn't have some of the programming and the wisdom that we think we have. They had a different version of that, right? And they were people just like us. You know, they created multiple meals throughout a day. They raised their children. They went to bed at night. They talked story. They made love. They danced. They wove fishing nets. They argued. They gossiped. They're just people living their life, right? And they're rural people specifically living their life. Of course, there was just like there is today, there's governmental challenges and frustrations that come and go. That, you know, someone starts some sort of contest over who whose land is what, and you know, some sort of law is passed down, and someone, you know, try to fight or scuffle. So people may redirect their attention for some time to protect their family or protect their homestead. But for the most part, they were farming, and they were fishing, and they were living, and they were engaged in the everyday life of sustainability, right? They didn't know it as that because it just was life, right? So the green movement or the indigenous wisdom movement, all these like kind of mental constructs that we hold on to today, are to go back to a more of an indigenous wisdom and that way of being where we don't have to identify it, we're just living it. So eventually this system of people living together rurally up in the mountains began to organize as people had abundance. So I imagine it was, you know, probably an elder, maybe someone that's been farming for years or someone that's really well-versed in some of the modalities of farming and everything that goes with that. And they appointed or elected or assigned a position called a konohiki, right? And so this was a manager or an office of management that looked out for the system, right? And he or she was responsible, probably he, but we can stay open because we don't know, was responsible for not just food production, like cultivating cuttings and seeds and putting them in the ground and getting food and eating it, but the food system, the larger food system. And that includes cultivation, that includes inputs and processing and distribution and storing and all, you know, all the work to make the tools to work in the garden, on the farms, the labor distribution. That also includes conservation. The kapu system was in place to, you know, stop people from cutting down certain trees that were upland that might have an impact upon the lower land. The kapu system was in place to stop overfishing of certain fish. So they could spawn and they would have more abundance. So the konohiki was sort of an office of a Bureau of Land Management and Conservation and our ag department, all this stuff sort of together, right? This was, imagine a wise elder who knew what was happening with the land and was able to help foster more abundance because they weren't... the motivation wasn't about creating wealth for yourself in the way that we know, but in the traditional way of creating abundance for yourself. So what did the konohiki manage? And he managed an area, or he or she managed an area, right? An area that's loosely defined by geographical boundaries. So these geographical boundaries could be the ocean, could be ridgelines or mountains or rivers. Right? So this is just a very sensible way that we ordered the world based on, you know, it's going to take a lot more work to get over that hill than it is to go down into that valley, right? And so these systems begin to emerge. We call them the ahupua'a, right? And so this was a land-based system, ahupua'a. This is a land-based designation, like watersheds, right? It's hard to imagine a watershed because water sheds into the ground here. But back in the mainland, you know, you were part of a watershed, whether you called it that or you resonated with that or not. So these are land-based systems. So Puna is one of these systems. And if you sort of envision, you're up here at the crater where the lava comes out, and you follow that down Chain of Craters Road to Kalapana, where the lava's flowing now. And if you sweep across through Kalapana and Kaimu on the coastal road, through Opikau, over to Kapoho, and past Shipman's, where the old bird sanctuary was, up to Paradise Park, you know, and then start coming back up Volcano Road through Keau and Mountain View, and back up again to Volcano National Park. You have a pie shape that goes from the mountain to the ocean, right? And so this is a very natural boundary, right? Because of Mauna Loa, because of the beach, because of the topography. So this was the larger system within that system, there was, just like in permaculture, there was flows of energy. We use sector maps and how people move. And so possibly the people that sort of gravitated in Kalapana area and Kaimu had a flow of energy up mountain through chain of craters up to volcano, right, possibly. And the people that lived more in Opikau or over in Kapoho sort of had a flow of energy maybe up towards Pahoa-ish. And the people that lived over there in the estates and Paradise Park and that whole plain area had a flow of energy up towards Mountain View and things like that. So maybe there was three sort of sections, right? You have to imagine, it takes a long time to go from one place to another at that time, right? So they would have localized, they would have made sense, they would have made trade agreements with people based on necessity, right? So that's sort of a less technical definition of what that ahupua'a system may have looked like here. But what's important to understand is that there was a system of resource management that was organized by a konohiki and was had full participation from everyone in the community. I've heard estimates that 90% of people were involved in fishing, either catching the fish, cleaning the fish, making nets for the fish, storing the fish, burying the bones of the fish, using it in the garden practices. Everybody was involved, and it wasn't because they had to be, it's because that's how life was. So if we look at that system, it went on for a number of years. And like I said, some people got distracted here and there. Maybe someone would marry outside the system, and maybe a system would shut down, right? If there's a prominent figure that's in the system, in one of those areas, those designated areas, and they would marry out, maybe that would go stagnant and everyone else would leave. Or the lava would come and people would just move over to a different site. Or they saw that one place was more abundant than another. You know, after years of observation, you're getting more yield, or you're noticing, you know, the breadfruit's bigger here or whatever, then they would just transition. So it was sort of a luxury of flexibility that they had because there wasn't private property as we know it. And so they were able to adapt. They were able to trade up and down. And they were able to unify their labor pool and their resources to create abundance for their community. That's the system. So that went on, like I said, for a number of years. And, of course, we know colonization came, sandalwoods got chopped down, monoculture and a different way of looking at the land of resource extraction began to permeate, and we lost some of that wisdom. But there is, over in Kalapana, where they said there might have been estimates of 100,000 people living in that plain area, that kind of larger plains area, 100,000 people in Lower Puna, in Kalapana, living 100% sustainably, no inputs, coming from off-island, right? And so now we have, what, like 50,000 people, roughly, in Puna, maybe 15,000 in Lower Puna, with over 80% of our food coming from off-island. So what's the main difference there is something we'll look at later today. Like, what's the difference?
Not sustainable.
Right, not sustainable. And also, also, I would argue some of the efficiencies and comfort that we have has made us complacent, right? For, you know, and it's not totally our fault. We don't have the wisdom passed down, but we can resource it. We can get to know it.
I think back then, my understanding was it was a collective mindset.
Right.
Which is individual.
Right.
Who's,
right.
Not, you know, individual.
Right.
Whatever.
So getting back to that collective mindset is something we want to do. And I believe that there's one man that I know that had been around for quite some time that had that. Uncle Robert was one of the, his property was one of the lone survivors of the lava flow in the 90s that went around him. I believe what I know of the man who has been described as like living aloha or love embodied, that he would have been a great konohiki, right? He had wisdom, he had kindness, he also had presence and he had direction, and he obviously organized a great group of people around him. He also had the insight that I, you know, as I've lived in Central America and Thailand that I haven't seen from someone of that generation. He had the insight to expand a system that would include everybody. So he organized the Ho'ohana Sustainable Talk Story in June of 2014. And his idea was, how can we bring everybody that lives here together? Everybody that's part of our family that lives here right now, how can we bring them together to make life better, right? This is a very Konohiki kind of concept, right? This isn't us and them. This is we live here. How can we make things better? What do we got to do to address sustainability, right? So he's not coming from like this very technical, like greenwashing, how can I utilize this movement to sell something, you know. He's coming from his heart, and he's saying, we got a problem here, we got to get together, and we got to make life better for each other. So I believe Uncle Robert embodied the energy of a Konohiki, and I like to imagine him as doing that, as an elder who's bringing people together. So like I said, he had this insight to create this Ho'ohana Sustainable Talk Story, or Sustainability Conference, we call it. And he brought an amazing group of people together to host these meetings week after week and talk about how, what does sustainability look like for our island? Who can we include? Who can we bring together to do that, right? And so on June 27th, 2014, like I said, just 3 months shy of 3 years ago, was a three-day conference hosted by Uncle Robert and his amazing group of support. And this is kind of where the first story meets up with the second story. Some of you know that date, June 27, 2014, because that's how we refer to the lava flow that came to Pahoa. It was the June 27th lava flow. So that night, for whatever reason, the lava started, right? And you know, it wasn't a few months until it started invoking some sort of fear into the hearts of people, and thinking about the concept of being cut off, you know, 130 being cut off and Pahoa being cut off. But it was just 5 weeks after the lava flow that we had Hurricane Azelle hit. And this was the largest tropical storm, or hurricane actually, to hit this part of the island in recorded history. It was a Category 4, 144 mile an hour winds, and it tested this community like never before, right? Trees fell, they fell on power lines, they fell across the road, people couldn't get out, people didn't have power. This fragile veil of sustainability that many felt like they had conquered was dissolved, because even if you had your family had off-grid and water catchment and everything, not everybody did, right? So there was people, there was neighbors that didn't have their needs met. Often, you know, their refrigerators and their freezers were tied to the grid. Their water pumps were tied to the grid. They couldn't get water, right? So we soon discovered, as much as we're like self-reliant survivalists here in Puna, that we're in it together. And that if our neighbor doesn't have it, then we don't have it. So people are hauling freezers over and hauling water back over, and we're supporting each other. It was quite beautiful. I remember the day after the storm. I was at the Permaculture Foundation of Hawaii at the time, and I was down on the Red Road, and there was trees everywhere. And we all went down there with our chainsaws and tractors, and we're working together. And some, I'll be honest, it was the first time I met some of my neighbors. Right? Because that's what disaster does. It brings us together. Right? So 2 weeks it went on like that, and it really cracked, made a little hole in the illusion of sustainability for a lot of us here in Puna. You know, people that feel like they have it realize that we don't have it, and that we got a lot of work to do for ourselves. So that was the first bit of that. And the lava was flowing, right? The lava was flowing, the lava was flowing. It's actually really interesting to me that it takes hurricanes and lavas for people that live on an island way out in the middle of nowhere to imagine that we could be screwed if something were to happen to us, you know, because we do live in a very delicate balance of stability out here, right? There's a number of people that are consider themselves self-reliant, survivalists, mountain men, communitarians, preppers, people that are here for different reasons, right? Because of peak oil, because of financial collapse, possible nuclear threat with North Korea now. Sorry to laugh, but that's new. A zombie apocalypse, you know, any number of reasons why we may experience challenges. They're very real. You know, I consider myself a prepper, not a doomsday prepper. I think it makes sense to be prepared for these things. And many of my friends, like Wade, we actively work towards sustainability and being prepared in a happy, heartfelt way. Like, it just makes good sense. We eat really well, and we have strong community, and our potlucks rock. And people have gardens around, and we catch our own water, and we have off-grid living. And of course, that could be more sustainable, but we're working towards that bit by bit. So the lava was flowing. Hurricane Azelle had just happened. The sustainability talk happened. This is the first night that I spoke in Pune since returning to the island, and I talked about interdependence. I snuck in on social permaculture. That's what I do. I tell them, I use the P word, the permaculture word, and people think I'm going to talk about gardening. And then I get my foot in the door, and that night I talked about sharing, and I talked about working together, and how we can lower our footprint significantly and get our needs met as a community if we embrace interdependence, if we move out of self-reliance or independent living and focus on interdependent living. I've lived with a number of people who have a strategy of, this is a lifeboat, I have a fence, I have a gate, I have a shotgun, I have food hidden, I'm ready. I'm ready for that zombie apocalypse. I'm ready for whatever's to come. And there's nothing wrong with that strategy, but it is very fear-based and is very divisive and separate. A strategy that I feel takes into consideration all of these concerns is one of interdependence. Right, you make yourself useful in the system that you're part of. That's what they did in the ahupua'a. They made themselves useful in the system that they were part of. So if challenging times comes, you're not going to get voted off the island because you make really good taro, or you're really sweet with the kids, or you've always been generous with your work or your labor or your resources, right? You make yourself indispensable. This is a strategy for survival of interdependence that we can embrace as a community. This is, as Uncle referenced back there, this is a we sort of mentality rather than a me sort of mentality, right? This is a circle structure rather than a triangle structure. This is us, right? And so if we begin to transition our thinking into that, we can begin to shore up self-reliance and community resiliency. We can have plan A, B, C, D, and F can be sort of taken care of because we're one large entity and we're not individuals living separately. So the talk on interdependence was at the heart of what we were doing at the Permaculture Foundation with our outreach. We had weekly free classes for people to come and attend, and we were just giving knowledge away. And in return, we made some beautiful connections. Our lifeboat now became a productive garden, a great network of friends, skill sets that we could share, you know, between us, right? That became our ark in times of need. So around September of 2014, mid-September, was the first modern ahupua'a discussion here at Hawaiian Sanctuary with Hunter, I remember. And the lava was flowing through the homesteads at the time, right? And so this was very real. That it was coming, and they just secured a year-long series of discussions like this one every Saturday, once a month, to talk about what a sustainable system looks like for our community. And month by month, what they discussed was the parts to the system, right? Like here's the plants to grow, here's how to take care of the bees, here's how you cultivate taro, all these parts. From my perspective as an admittedly critical person, I felt like we missed the opportunity to discuss the system as a whole. You know, how can we look at the larger system and what is our place in it? And today we're going to go into that a little bit more. So, at that same time, a group of forward-thinking people, the HSCA, the Hawaii Sustainable Communities Alliance, started a series of meetings called the Lava Zone Meetings, right? And people started showing up to discuss what the heck are we going to do if another storm was to come, or if we get cut off from 130 if the lava comes. What are we going to do as a community? And they listed 11 different categories. They were transportation, food security, health and well-being, education, things like this, real needs for our community. And you would think this would be an opportunity to share some of these sort of alternative or fringe ideas that many of us have been working on in the intentional communities or in the permaculture natural farming communities. This would be an opportunity for our voices to be heard. And time again, as people presented alternatives and options, reality snuck in and said, we don't have time for that. Food forest is great, but what about next week? What about next month, right? So time and time again, this kind of scary word of best practices slowly killed some of our motivation, right? Best practices. In times of need, during times of self-reliance or preparedness because of an imminent threat like lava or something that just happened with a hurricane, we don't have time for alternatives. We don't have time to vision our future. You know, the shit has hit the fan, you know, and we need to prepare right then, right? We need best practices. Unfortunately, in like food security, best practices look like pallets of Spam and Cheetos and bottled water, you know, right? Who wants that? You know? And so best practices didn't look like we couldn't build temporary structures because they weren't in alignment with the county's codes. You know, we could maybe throw up some tents or some tarps, but that's not sustainable, you know, in high winds, or that's not going to protect people. So time and time again, best practices snuck in. And what I realized was, as much as I love this community, I need to step back from their best practices, and I need to go back to the drawing board and think about how we can better prepare ourselves as a community for the next time something like this were to happen, right? How can we take these alternatives and turn them into best practices? How can we create new systems and make the old systems obsolete, right? So this is where the discussion went in my head and around some of the circles I was with. So slowly the lava began to threaten Pahoa. Some people left. That's how they deal with imminent threat, something that maybe we couldn't do if it was peak oil or financial collapse or zombie apocalypse. So this strategy is only useful. 10% of the people actually of this area left when the lava is coming. So this is a strategy that's useful in certain situations, but not in all. Chances are we're going to have to figure this out, right? We're going to have to figure out how can we take care of our needs as a community. So the lava, as you know, or most of you know, it threatened the town. Fear rose, stress rose. People talked about best practices. Some of the solutions were air-dropping in pallets of food and things like that because we needed to take care of our immediate needs, right? And then the lava began to subside, and so did the conversation. That year, 2015, Uncle Robert's passed away. February 15, 2015, God bless him, he was a beautiful man. He passed away. The HSCA and the modern ahupua'a meetings, the energy for them began to taper out because this was no longer an imminent threat. And some of this energy that had built up begin to go back into everyday life, right? And that's what happens. And so me and some people that I'm acquainted with, we kept working on it. And we kept visioning what needed to be done around that. So some of the solutions are very personal ones, right? They're individual responsibility. They're making sure that in a time of need that you have your basic needs met, food, water, shelter. And that means living off-grid or having an off-grid alternative, and a generator is not necessarily one of those, right? And solar panels and things like that, and wind turbines are alternatives that have a life cycle to them as well that we need to be aware of, right? But this is a good stepping stone alternative. Having some of our food grown locally is on our land. Best estimates from people that are really honest is 30 to 50%. People that are like hardcore working on this every day, subsistence farming, maybe up to 80%. But this is a stretch, right? And so the reality is we need not just the backyard revolution and the permaculture and the natural farming at our house. We need larger systems also to sustain us around us in our community. Right now, this island ships off 80% of the food it grows. It's usually cash crops, things like papayas and coffee and things like that. So that number is sort of doesn't include all the subsistence food that we grow to eat on a daily basis. So strategies include personal for you and your family, right? And what that looks like to create healthy, thriving, vibrant personal systems. This is one strategy. And this is an important strategy. And if you're not there yet, this is probably where you need to put your attention, right? Like what's that old saying, you know, put your own gas mask on first before you help others, right? So you need to get your needs. I think that's oxygen, not a G. So you need to get your needs met first, right? That's pretty important. And then there is other people in the community that are creating value-added products or things that you can utilize at home. Your morning coffee could be totally from the island, from the beans to the cream to the honey. Your morning smoothies, from the cacao to the bananas to the spirulina and to the kale, can be completely from the island. Or omelets, from the eggs to the peppers to the goat cheese, can be completely from the island, right? And this goes for every meal, you know, if you really look at it. So if you are putting your money into the local system, this is just as important as you growing your own food at home, because you're helping these systems thrive, right? So I realize sometimes it's a little bit more expensive, but it is a localized system. So if we take money to the local grocery store and that goes towards food that's being shipped in, it's really like a water catchment with a hole in it, right? Like a water catchment is where we save up for the dry time, and if there's a hole in it, there's no water there, right? And so if we're constantly putting our resources into a container with a hole in it, when we go to look in times of need or for community resiliency, there's no resources for us. So if we are voting with our dollar and we're giving our money outside the system, we're contributing to those ships coming in. We're contributing to a dependency, right? So there's a lot that we can do personally before we begin to extend those spheres of influence larger and larger. As we do that, as we grow our sphere into now maybe into our community, into the people that live around us, we can look at ways of sharing resources, right? Not everybody needs a tractor, a lawnmower, a backhoe. Perhaps we could share some of those with tool shares and things like that, right? There's sometimes that as we expand our circle, life gets a little bit more complicated. And there's sometimes as we expand our circle, life gets a little bit more easeful. And hopefully that we can balance that out as we work together as a community. The hawai'i that is forming down there in railroad area, right? A lot of people are building up at the same time. They're working on basic needs, and they would benefit from having a system in place of builders that could go and support each other, of farmers that could go and give advice to people and give design advice and help them install it. So labor pools that are reputation-based, right, that protect the needs of the worker, that would be nice around here, and also protect the needs of the employer, that also would be nice around here, right? So there's things that we can envision that sort of begin to fall under the realm of sustainable cooperative or sustainable ag cooperative, right? And there's going to be a handout coming. I think Michelle went to print it because we ran out of ink. And we talk about some of what a sustainable ag cooperative would have. Services is one, supplies and production. And you'll have this handout shortly. So design services, consultation, and education is an ag service that people could benefit around here, right? A lot of people have land. They don't know what to do with it. So more than likely what we do is we shotgun approach it. We try everything. So people get here and they put, that's my citrus orchard and that's this and that's that, and they try everything and they put a lot of energy into that, and then they begin to like dial it back to what's working. But if someone like Wade or other permaculture designers came onto your property, had a consultation with you and discussed what you could do with your land, looked at the topography of the land, looked at the reality of where you were at on the land like they did in the ahupua'a system, and said, okay, you sort of have a responsibility to grow these things. This wants to grow here. How does that fit in with your desires, right? Like, what would you like to grow as a cash crop for yourself? What do you like to eat, you know, and what does really well here? And so all those factors considered are going to save you a lot of time and money, right? So that's a service that people could benefit within a sustainable ag cooperative. A certification service, so you're certified organic in a way that is not extreme and is cost effective. Or you're certified as a Korean natural farmer, so your land is certified. So if you want to sell your food, you have some sort of certification. Like I mentioned before, a reputation-based labor distribution service would be really helpful for people around here. It's hard because you don't need labor all the time. You only need labor when maybe you're planting or you're harvesting, things like that. Would be really great to be able to call someone up and say, I could use five people on this day, and they come and they're credible and they're maybe been trained and they're sanctioned and they're have insurance, right? So something like that. That would be useful for people around here. Veterinary services. As we vision a food security future for ourselves, we imagine animals in that system for sure. And so we want to make sure that those animals are being treated well and respected and taken care of, right? So these are healthy veterinarian services. And then the other side of that, the processing and preparing of both the livestock and the food, services like that, mobile butchers would be part of that. I lost some people now, I know, but this is part of a food security future that we envision. This is just a part of it. We can't really do successful agriculture without animals in that system. Whether you slaughter them or not, that's up to you, right? But animals in the system is super important. A food broker, someone that can help. Farmers are busy farming, right? And people that are growing food are busy with that. But someone that can help make those calls where you say, hey, I got choke avocados going off. I don't know what to do with them. And that person has connections, you know, with locavore and with the local markets and things like that. And maybe they have a truck and they can come pick it up. Or maybe there's a mobile food hub who comes, picks up food, drives around, sells food. The food never really ends up anywhere in a warehouse. It's just a mobile food system. Things like this would benefit our community. Marketing and promotional services for any farm that has a value-added product or has some sort of outreach for eco-entrepreneurs or something like that. Many farmers don't know how to do marketing and promotion, and that's okay. So once a year or once in their lifetime when they need this service, it would be nice to have a farmer-friendly or a rancher-friendly organization be able to help them with that. Conservation and restoration services. So in permaculture, we have zone 4 and 5. Back home in Nebraska, we had the hedgerows, right? There was always something that was left. There was always a wooded area around the farm that was left for windbreaks or for animals and things like that. And so sometimes restoring the land back to its original splendor, or just preserving it, that could be a consultation, that could be money channeled through grants to help you do that. There's money out there for these kind of things, right? So these are all aspects of a sustainable ag cooperative, right? So now we go to ag supply co-op. So power and heavy equipment, right? How often do you need a tractor, or do you need a soil turner, right? Or do you need a chipper, right? Not very often. So having one that and maintaining those things is a real bear. So having one that's maintained professionally, that you can call on locally, that you can rent out, that you can utilize, or multiple, these sustainable ag cooperatives, we could have multiple of these in this area. It doesn't even have to be centralized. It could be organized online, and it could exist in different areas. We can get away from thinking about this being one place that we go to, but it could be as well. It could be multiple places. Materials that are available, like mulch and compost. So mulch that's created with maybe fallen albizias and inoculated with Korean natural farming, that is fire ant free, that we don't have to drive a Hilo for, right? This is a growing soil is one of the biggest, most beautiful things we can do for the land here. And we have sort of a strange way of doing that right now. We go and we pick up stuff that we don't know what's in it from far away, and we truck it back. And meanwhile, there's logs all over the place. So we can activate that. We can figure that out. We can also, like Clive's doing, we can grow the grass, the cane grass, and we can thrash it, and we can cover it up, and we can turn that into green compost. We can mix that in with the wood chips, things like that. So having people that are doing that, so we can go there to do that. All these jobs that I'm listing have been put on the shoulders of small-scale farmers and eco-entrepreneurs and people wanting to make the world better, you know, and that's hard enough as it is, right? Tending to your garden, tending to your land is hard enough as it is. So having a place, an ag cooperative, to help you with some of these things is a real blessing. Something that you pay into, something that you maybe can trade, maybe there's alternative currency that holds it all together, and we can get some of the money out of it completely. I give you this for that, and we're all getting our needs met, right? And because of we're a high poverty area, because of some of our challenges with lava and storms and stuff like that, we can hopefully channel some money from government grants that will help take care of some of these things so that we can help you. Because farming the land is a very popular topic right now. It's what people are encouraging, right? So helping a pathway to get funds into people. I got a little bit ahead of myself because that's down here in the credit cooperative. So inputs, fertilizers, and amendments. There's no reason why any of that has to come from off-island. Korean Natural Pharmacists has taught us that. The calcium that the soil needs, we can get from the coral. There's nitrogen and potassium and all the different ways that Korean Natural Farming has covered that we can make those amendments. But most people I know don't have time for that shit, right? Like, it's just another thing to take on, right? They're just trying to keep their self above water. So if you could go somewhere, there's people back on the mainland that have compost tea collectives. And so they pay in, a person shows up with a truck, sprays down their harvest with freshly made compost tea. And this is just an amendment that they would have paid for anyway, a petrochemical more likely that they would have got from off island. So this is a different way of doing it. This is a sustainable way. This is a regenerative way. This is a way that's pono with the land and is going to help build your soil and hopefully translate into a thriving, resilient future for yourself. So a sustainable ag cooperative could also have land broker. So this is like a dating service between people that have wisdom and land and people, younger people that have energy and enthusiasm, right? And so there's the population of farmers is aging, and there is new people coming here all the time. If there's some sort of certification program, a training program, that we got some young lad up to par and we help get them onto some land to help tend, to help steward some of that, it's like a dating service, right? That we could help broker. There's also other ways to get land here in Puna for people that have excitement that don't have land. The Bishop land, the Queen's land through Kamehameha School has 800 acres down here in Lower Puna that they lease for $100 an acre, which is quite affordable. So there is ways that we can get people on land, but even the best of us, you know, someone coming out of school or someone coming out of a permaculture design or someone that really has the ambition, they're going to need support with many of these things that I mentioned, right? So if we can get them on the land and we can help you with your land, then we can begin to organize cooperatives like this that can really help you with some of those needs. Let me just finish this list. So fundraising, advocacy, and education, because you're part of a cooperative, maybe your land, we're doing soil tests, or we're seeing what's happening there, we're watching things, we're comparing things. You know, Locavore Store has an amazing database of information over the years from what they've collected from people where they're at, you know, in elevation and where they're located and how much they're producing. And so these kind of things are really, as we begin to collect information, work together as a cooperative, we can see, man, they got choke this and they got that going off and there's a whole bunch of that, and let's sort of try to mirror some of what they're doing. Let's learn from each other, right? Instead of like, it's like, I never see my neighbors and I'm living on the farm and I'm so busy and, you know, and this life that a lot of us live, that's, you know, and maybe we don't have time to get together to talk about these things. But if we have an office or a system put together, sustainable ag cooperatives that are taking on some of this information, we can begin to share it with each other, because we all want each other to do better for ourselves, right? So like I said, when the storm came and people were thought that just worrying about themselves was going to do it, it wasn't enough, right? Because we're all in this together. So administration and bookkeeping is the last service I have on here, is the ag production. And like I said, this handout is coming. So this concept, this sustainable ag concept, I called R Konohiki, right? Because it's R for one united resource, and Konohiki for this is a way that we can manage the land, right? But it's R Konohiki, right? It's not one person just saying this is how it is. It's an office. It's a cooperative. It's all the people in the community paying into this, benefiting from this. This is one united resource, our Konohiki. This is one way that we can look at things from a grassroots perspective. There's governmental perspectives, there's regional plans, all that stuff exists, and that's great that that's happening. But those are the people that want to drop pallets of Spam and bottled water and Cheetos in times of need. So if we don't look at these solutions, take them very seriously, in times of ease, like now, and set ourselves up with these solutions and these models, then if something were to happen, that zombie apocalypse may come, and if something were to happen, peak oil, financial collapse, storms, lava, any number of things, that's not the point. Like I said, that's not the time that we talk about this, because then we go into best practices. So our job as responsible community members is to change those best practices, right, together. Recently, and I'm going to kind of close with this, I was reminded of there's a new development coming into Pahoa, right, that we're aware of. It's going to be a larger Malama market and McDonald's, I've heard, and a coffee bean and things like this. And there's quite an uproar online about this. People are upset, rightfully so. They're like, this is our small town. What the heck are you guys doing with this outside influence? And they said, they should do this, they should do that, right? But this they is developers. These are people that make buildings. They put down concrete and they make buildings and they rent them out. That's business. That's what they do, for better or worse. To suggest that they have a conscience is misunderstanding how that system works. So the they is us, right? If we want these systems in these markets, then we need to get our shit together individually and as a community and create small organizations. And we need to be the they that can pay the rent on something like that. If that's what we want to do, people, if we expand that model more frequently, so maybe there's a farmer's market that's always in Pahoa. But if, you know, there's Fridays down at that Smiley does down at Green Lake. There are Saturdays over at Uncle's. There are Saturdays in Pahoa. There are Sundays in Makuu. You know, there's possibilities. One thing I think would be nice is a mobile food hub, a van that drives around picking up food from people that have abundance, just meets them at the side of the road, and then people know it's going to be parked at a certain place at a certain time, you know, every week, and you go there and get things. This is one idea. Some of these concepts of like centralized markets or grocery stores or whatever, these are great, but I think we need to think more flexible, more malleable, you know, these systems that we can sort of begin to engage with that can work with our community and work with us every day. So anyway, that's a little bit about the story of the ahupua'a, and up until Uncle Robert and sustainability and the lava flowing, and then some of the community discussion around that and how that was beautiful, but there were some challenges. And then about how some of the solutions, the personal solutions and the community solutions. Our Konohiki is one of those solutions. So I have a small organization called Lower Puna Rising, and we're a design build collective, and we really just help vision some of these ideas, right? We help formalize them and put them into place so that we can then present them business plans and grants to get money for them so we can do them. It's a lofty goal. We don't have a place, we don't have money, we have social capital, and we have the will, and we know that it's important, and we have ambition. And so there's no promises, we're just working towards these goals. Our Konohiki is one of our flagship projects. The Community Hive, which we've hosted a 3-month series of community meetings to vision that, is another project that we're working on. And so today, the second part of today, is we're going to break into groups, and we're going to do some mind mapping together and some brainstorming together about what some of these systems may look like. So it's not just coming from me, that it's coming from you. I'm going to ask you to stick around so I can harvest some of your ideas, and so that we can put this into our larger vision, and as we go seek money and as we begin to build it in the future, that your voice is heard around that. And so we'll be hosting a series of meetings for this reason, and this is one of them. So anyway, thanks for coming, and that's where we're at. We're going to take a 15-minute break and stretch, and hopefully connect in with each other. Okay? Yeah.